First, thank everybody for coming on this beautiful Friday afternoon. I want to thank our co-sponsors, the History Department, the History Club, the Intellectual Life Fund, the University Diversity Committee, our staff here at Fowl Library, the College of Social and Behavioral Sciences, and the College of Extended Learning. The title of today's talk is Constructive Postmodernism in China Today. That may be an unfamiliar term to some of you. I know it was to me until just a few months ago when I met Professor Wang and some of his colleagues in Claremont. But I think after today you'll have a very good understanding of what that means. And it's a very important topic, I think, in Chinese culture and in Chinese politics today. Our speaker today, Professor Zhihe Wang, was born in Beijing, China, and he's the director of the Institute for Postmodern Development of China and the executive director of the China Project, the Center for Process Studies in Claremont, California. He's also director of the Center for Constructive Postmodern Studies and professor of philosophy at the Harbin Institute of Technology. Professor Wang received his BA and MA in philosophy from Peking University in Beijing and his PhD from the Claremont Graduate University. His many areas of specialty include process philosophy, also something that we're going to learn a lot more about today, constructive postmodernism, ecological civilizations, and something called the Second Enlightenment. Since 2002, he and his team have established more than 20 research institutes for constructive postmodern studies at universities throughout China. He has helped organize more than 70 international conferences on ecological civilization, sustainable urbanization, ecological agriculture, postmodern law, science and spirituality, education reform, social responsibility in business, land and social justice, and management. And he has published extensively on all of these topics. And it is with great pleasure today that I introduce Professor Zhihe Wang. Please welcome.
Thank you. I hope you can give me more hands here. The reason I see this way because, you know, according to Chinese organic philosophy, everything is interrelated to each other. So our finger relates to our heart. When you give me a hand, you actually you massage your heart. So you do your good yourself, okay? Yeah. Here I want to express my deep thanks to Professor Murray for inviting us to here. Yeah, also want to thank our school, you know, for having us here. You know, that's why today, in order to honor our audience, I wear my favorite suit. Yeah, we call it a performance uniform. And you know, I'm not a good speaker. You know, I just talk whatever I like to talk. So it's So today the topic is constructive postmodernism in China today. In order to save some time, I just from now on, I call the CP. CP in other meaning the Communist Party. Yeah, CP. Constructive postmodernism in China today. Yeah. The first question is what is the constructive postmodernism? Yeah. The you know the of course this one definition you can develop a book can give a lot of definition. Yeah. So it's the but it makes things easier. We see how do we understand CP in China? We understand that is the CP refers to a ways of thinking built upon process thought that favors the pluralistic but integrative worldview and the practice. If you ask me give you one sentence to explain what is the CP or constructive postmodernism, I will see we try to looking for the third way, you know, between tradition and modern. Or you can call it a kind of combination between tradition and modern. And I think that's the very brief definition. Yeah. So it's the this in the West when people talk about constructive postmodernism, most people think about the French school or deconstruction, right? So that's That's why we call ourselves constructive postmodern, which try to different from the French school, because they immediately focus on deconstruction. The reason why we pick a constructive, because we thought that China, after so many political movements, we already deconstructed too much. It's time to hold on something. It's time to hold people together. It's time to construct something. That's why we identify ourselves constructive postmodernism. But on the same time, we also try to reflect on the negative consequence of modernity. That's why we also call ourselves postmodernism. Yeah, but different from the French school. Yeah. There are some leading person. We should mention their name. One is the Professor Whitehead, who used to be the professor of Harvard University. Yeah. After retired from England, he was hired by Harvard to teach there. In Harvard, he established his whole philosophy system. We call the process philosophy or organic philosophy. Another is Dr. Cobb. Dr. Cobb is our mentor, right now living in Claremont. He's a founding director of Center for Process Studies, also our president of IPDC. Yeah. This is David Griffin, is my supervisor. Yeah. So this is the three, you know, you also can add more and more people there. Yeah. Another question is the emergence of CP in China. You know, when you trace back the history, because Professor Murray studied history, we should mention the history. Yeah. Before 1995, in China, very few, little people know about what is the CP, constructive postmodernism. The only one postmodernism they know is deconstructive postmodernism or deconstruction. Yeah. In 1995, we published a book called A Reenchantment of Science. This word, no matter how knowledgeable you are, probably you couldn't find in the Weber dictionary what it means in English, reenchantment. Yeah. But so that's why even it's harder translated into Chinese. Yeah. But the smart people like me, I found a way. Yeah. I gave it a new name. This is the name I gave this book. Yeah. So I think the better probably become more creative. So we call it the postmodern science. Yeah, the 后现代科学. Yeah. Then I think it turned out to be very good result. This book become the bestseller book. Right now in China already published, republished 6 editions. Yeah, so sometimes a name makes sense. Yeah. This is our supervisor, David Griffin, yeah, the author. Yeah. So the second question is the Chinese acceptance of constructive postmodernism. So we see that 1995, that before that, nobody knew what is the CP. But 18 years pass, right now, the CP has become quite an influential movement in China. Yeah. So I show you evidence. That's 2012, they select which opinion is more valuable in China. So fortunately, this point of view by Professor Tang Yijie was elected as the number one valuable point of view. Yeah, his main point is that in China right now there are two big movements. One is the zeal, the Chinese resurgence of traditional culture. Another is the constructive postmodernism. According to his opinion, these two movements can work together, hand in hand, under the leadership of Marxism, because Marxism in China is still the dominant ideology. So China can avoid the mistake the West made and go to the postmodern society, or you call it the Second Enlightenment society, smoothly. No need to repeat the mistake, the same mistake West made. That is his main point. I think that's why people select this one as the most valuable opinion. Yeah, this is if somebody can read the Chinese, this is the Chinese, yeah, you can see. I didn't lie here. This is the Professor Tang. It's the Professor Tang who proposed this opinion. Yeah. Probably in China, most people know Professor Tang. Yeah. He's a professor of Peking University. Also recently he got an award. He got an award called the Wuyizhang Humanities and Social Science Award. You know, in China, in the past 30 years, our whole society or government put too much emphasis on the science and technology. So a lot of money award go to the science and the technology. Very, very few the big award go to the humanities and social science. This is the biggest one so far in China, called Wuyizhang Humanities and Social Science Award. So the Professor Tang got 1 million Chinese money for the award. Yeah. So this is he's the only one person working on the humanities field got this award. Yeah. So I think this is a pretty big honor. Yeah. So also some people said that the CP is the biggest movement after Zhang Duwei's pragmatism. Yeah. So during this lunch, Professor Maria, we talk about the Hu Shi. Yeah. The Hu Shi is one of the leading person in China who promote pragmatism back to 1920. Yeah. So that is after pragmatism, right now people think maybe CP is probably one of the biggest or influential movement. Yeah. I mean from outside. Yeah. This is another professor, Yue Daiyun, said in her article, he mentioned how China should face the world. There are two ways. One way China can pursue the global hegemony, right? That's the way. It's not a good way. People will hate us. Another way, probably found another better way. The Professor Yue think China should embrace, accept constructive postmodernism. That's make China go to a sustainable way. Yeah, sustainable way. So this is the Professor Yue, is also a very leading scholar in China. Yeah, he's the president of China Comparative Literature Association. Very, very, very sharp, smart lady. Yeah. And calling Professor Tang, if the better choice, we better choose constructive postmodernism. Yeah. Because it's this way, not only to the good, to ourselves, also to the world, become more harmony. Yeah. Harmonized. So it's very funny. This is the best opinion, valuable opinion. Eventually, the same year was selected by exam. In China, every year we have the national entry exam, 高考. Yeah. So every school teacher they try to guess what the exam will be. Yeah. This is the guess. They think this year will be take this will the put this paragraph in the exam. So that's why they ask student answer this question to do the practice. So they see I'm not sure whether eventually this appear on the exam or not. But anyway, you can see the influence there. Yeah, the influence there. Yeah. Yeah. This is I just mentioned the exam. Yeah, they put the value up there. So we a lot of, so far, more than 20 books already translated into China. And also, you know, this is the book. This is the translator, yeah. And also we have the publications, yeah. Especially we have the newspaper called the Cultural Communication. Yeah, it's we publish here. Just 1 year between 2012 to 13, so we found 96 articles on constructive postmodernism. You can see the topic, you can see, is very, very diverse. Yeah, you can older people to write, blah, 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 people just voluntarily to do their research. So the topic is very, very diverse, yeah. And besides the publication, translation, also Professor Marie mentioned we have more than 20 centers. Right now, actually, we have 25 parts of the constructive postmodern centers across China. So we like to talk to our friend. If you mention our name, you go when you go to China, you guarantee you can get a free lunch. This is from the north to south. Yeah, today, you know, like the Professor Lu from Harbin Normal. Harbin, you know, this is in the very north, across the border with Russia. Yeah, also in the south, we have in Zhanjiang. You know, Zhanjiang, the Guangdong province. We also have a center. The very, very, yeah, far. So this is the, yeah. And this is our first center established in Guilin. I have ever been to Guilin, Li River, yeah, the Guangxi province. Yeah, this is recently in the HIT, Harbin. Yeah. This is 2 years ago in Nanking. Yeah, we set up one. This is the last year in Guangzhou. So each center, they have a different focus, depend on their own interest. This center, they focus on the personal philosophy and system management. Yeah, system management. Yeah. This is that's it. We have visiting scholar. Today, I bring some of them. Yeah, to have some free lunch here. It's we tell people we study hard here. Actually, we have lots of fun also. Yeah, so enjoy life. You can see some people here, right? Yeah, it's I think the visiting scholar program is very important. You know, each people is like a seed. You know, gradually become a group, become a big tree. Yeah. When they back to China, they write article, they write a book, they give a lecture, they teach. So the influence, day by day, yeah, become bigger and bigger. So the conference, as Professor Murray mentioned, is another bigger program we are running. Because you know, there are big difference between a Western conference and the Chinese conference. Do you know what's the difference? The most Western conference. I think most conference Western conference is a conference. After conference, people put the conference paper in the libraries. In the library, maybe 20 years ago, somebody go to the library do some research. But in China, the conference today, somebody probably put the idea into practice. Yeah, they easily cross the line between theory and practice. Here, because people emphasize the value free, you know, probably better with scholar limit yourself on the campus. Yeah, but in China, people easily cross the line. So this is you can see the good or bad, but anyway, I think the Chinese conference, you know, that's why we spend so much energy, so much money to work on the conference organizing. So far, we already organized the 70. Those conferences, you can see the influence there. Yeah, after the conference, people go to their own organization. Some they are official, some they are the scholar. You know, the idea can be spread very quickly. Yeah, very, very quickly. Yeah. So this is the first one in Beijing. So this is Professor, this is Professor Yuan. That time the, he is the Vice the Minister of Education, 教育部部长. So after the conference, he became the Minister of Education of China. 现在成为教育部政部长. So we like to say, okay, everybody related to process of constructive postmodernism got a promotion. In many ways, a promotion. Yeah. That's him. Mm. That's my supervisor, David Green. Yeah, the conference among those 70 conferences, the topic very diverse. This is about the science and the spirituality. We pretend to know everything. Yeah. It's the and this is the in Suzhou conference work together with the Suzhou government and the Suzhou University. We have a center in Suzhou about the sustainable urbanization. Yeah. This is the Suzhou mayor Wang Rong. Right now he probably is the mayor of Shenzhen, right? Yeah. He's the Paulo Solari is the one of the leading founder of the Eco City, Paulo Solari. We also have a conference on the ecological agriculture. This was together with the Hunan government. This is in Clermont every year we have the Ecological Civilization Forum. So far we already organized the 7 forums. This year will be the 8th. So every year almost 100 come to China. So this is the this is the last year conference. Taking picture is the very important part of the Chinese conference. Because that is the way the Chinese like group, the sense of belonging, the sense of community. This is the we also have the conference on the education reform that happened in this take place in the Harbin Normal. So the also the this is a coming conference on the April 25th to 26th. So that you are more than welcome to join us. I'm guarantee you can make a lot of a new friend. Also the next year another big one, you are also welcome to come. So this is the maybe 2,000 people will come to join this conference. So the another program we run is called the lectures in China. So far we already arranged the 360 lectures. The most time the government what the government said maybe they do some propaganda, but I think that for the people, so that's why we trust the people to people, this communication, face to face. So that's kind of dialogue, communication is very, very important. So that's why we like to arrange people lecture in China. So the for the young people, most Chinese young people, they start probably, deeply influenced by Hollywood, the movie. People think every American people they live a big house, bigger car, fancy life. No need to work, just sitting there watching the TV. Talk. Have you ever seen the TV series called Friends? There's lots of Chinese people like that. They think that's American life, sitting there, watch, talk, no need to work. I come here, I found American people, they are hardworking, they take responsibility, they go to do the volunteer job, they take our family, not just sitting there, talk. So you can see the big and the misleading image. That's why we like around the people, two people to talk. So that's the people say, wow, these are really people. What they said, it really makes sense. Not just the like the TV, the movie, misleading people. We also the lecture, some lecture, across the whole China, even give one in the Central Party School. Somebody know what's the Zhongyang Dangxiao Central Party School? In China, every the governor, minister, before you got to promotion, you have to go to the party school, the central party school. That is the this is her training. Yeah. So that's the part of school. So it's the this is our president, Dr. Cobb, go to China, give a talk, meet the people. Yeah. This is with the Guangxi governor. Yeah. This is with the lead director of the Religion Bureau. Yeah. Ye Xiaowen. We also have the summer academy. This is another avenue we training the people, educating people. So our summer academy very interesting. Not only the student, also some professor, staff, faculty also joined us. Yeah. So last year, the Ding Wen and his wife, Professor Yang, and their children work on IT also joined us. We call the Constructive Postmodern Family. Yeah. So the people very. So this year we are going to have this summer academy in Mudanjiang, a very beautiful place. You're welcome to join us if you like some. Yeah, this is the. That's the reason why I put the postmodern wedding, because 2 years ago we have a summer academy. There's after our academy, everybody volunteered. If you like, you can share some experience. One girl shared her experience. She said after this summer academy, she want to have a postmodern wedding, or CP wedding, constructive postmodern wedding. We ask, what do you mean by constructive postmodern wedding? He said he just joined her sister's wedding, like that. The lemon seed, 1 mile. Yeah, Yingxin Chudui, pick up the groom, a bright groom, right? Xinliang. It's also the couple hundred tables for the dinner, big banquet. And 80% of the food nobody touched. They just left. She saw this is the big waste. Yeah. Is there some way can have the make your wedding become more meaningful? So that's why she used the constructive postmodern wedding. By constructive postmodern wedding, she said that she wants to take her fiance to go to the orphanage, bring some food, clothes for them. Also go to the elder retired community, to show their love. I think it's really, one person can really make a difference, right? Yeah. We also have a kindergarten. We found that it's hard to get in university or high school, because high school, they are busy in prepared exams, the national entry exam. So that the kindergarten is the place too easy to get in, because the children is more open. And the kindergarten is more open for their curriculum. Yeah. So that's why so far we already have a 10 Whitehead kindergarten. If you like children, you're welcome to visit them when you come to China. Yeah, it's very, very lovely. Also build the environment, go to ecological. Yeah. So this is make the children feel the link to the nature. The third question is the impact of constructive postmodernism. Yeah. I think the idea, okay, maybe just the leave on the campus. So in the book, nothing influenced on the society. It's not true. Actually, really already you can see the influence day by day there. Why is there, I think the constructive postmodernism already changed the people's view on postmodernism. Before that, people, as I just mentioned, people think there's only one kind of postmodernism, is a deconstruction. Yeah. So right now, people realize that, there's another kind of postmodernism. Yeah. So that's why this is Professor Xiaoming Chen, is a professor at Peking University, one of the leading scholars in the study of the postmodernism. Yeah. He said, we should pay more attention to the construct postmodernism. Yeah. And also this is Xia Yong. Yeah. So this is saying many postmodernists have some positive and constructive side. Yeah. This is our, we call it constructive postmodern general. And he said CP is a new attitude toward the relationship between humans and nature, individuals and society, individuals and the individual. Because he also teaches in the National School Academy, a lot of general. One day they asked him, you mentioned the constructive postmodernism. What is the constructive postmodern war? They asked him, do you know what his answer? What is the constructive postmodern war? 什么是后现代战争? 建设后现代战争? His answer is no war. I think that is it's pretty wise. Yeah. The second point is the CP challenges the Chinese to rethink modernization by pointing out its negative consequence. Yeah. You know, in the past 1,000 years, the whole China, we want to become modern. Modernization is the whole China's goal. Yeah, from the government to the lay people, people want to become modern. Yeah. Nobody even think about it. There is some dark side or negative consequence of modernization. But through the CP, people realize there's another side. Yeah, so, you know, everything have yin yang, but in the beginning, we just focus on the yang. Yeah, so this is way Fu Wu mentioned. Maybe the cost of modernization is too huge that the Chinese leaders consciously or unconsciously started to show their interest, concern, and absence of constructive postmodernism. Yeah. So the Wu is also the dean and the humanities of Zhejiang Brascos TV University. Another the professor Pei also used to be our visiting scholar. He said, as a matter of fact, the Chinese people and the Chinese government are slowly but gradually accepting constructive postmodern ideas and putting them into practice. Yeah, that is really there's some influence there. Yeah, even this example that some local government official, they try to use this idea, put it into practice in their area. Yeah. Like here I give example, one is the Zhuhai, and another is the Yichang. This is they try to use this idea build their ecological city. Yeah, I think that is really something. Even the Zhuhai is a small city, 2.3 million. I think if they really can build very well, that's a very good example. Make people see the CP is not just an idea, only practical, only workable. And you know, Chinese people, they are really learning very fast. If this is a good example, they easily to follow. Yeah, so that's why I feel very happy to see that. Yeah. And the third point is that the CP enrich and color the contemporary Chinese academia. Yeah. You know, when you see the topic, the field, day by day, you can see it become more and more bigger. The people, use this idea to work on their field. It's very, very diverse. Even the, Professor Murray worked on the Feng Baiju, and he must know the Chinese called party study. Yeah. You know, the according to this author, they think right now our traditionally party history study just focus on the mainstream. You know, we ignore the people work on the margin. Yeah. Also, people just in Chinese history, we say, oh, Mao is right, some bad guy is wrong. You know, this is the two strands, 两条路线都扔. Yeah, this is the kind of simplifies the history. You know, actually, the history is worked by many people. Yeah, the reason why Communist Party can win, can take over the power, because a lot of people work toward this direction, make it happen. So our history, the party history, traditionally just ignore those people, focus on the big leader. So I think the constructive postmodernism help the scholar think a different way. So I think it's very good. So the some people even use this idea to study the Chinese population policy, birth control policy. Right now you can see the China, we are suffering the negative consequence of a one child policy. You know why? Maybe some of you are the one child. You know, the one child become too spoiled, like a small emperor, small king, the whole family around them. So they don't know how to interact with other people, how to communicate with other people. Also that become big problem later, you see. Also we have the education reform. I think the most time traditionally the Chinese philosopher, they look down upon the educator. They look at the educator, they ignore the philosopher. They think they just talk, the idle idea. So we help them the dialogue, help each other. I think that is really, really productive. So in China, quite often, right now they're working on the new curriculum. This is very, very important. If the new idea can get in the new curriculum, that more children, more classroom, more school can get better. So the Xiao Manzhu used to be the president of Central Education Academy. So he used to in charge of the curriculum reform. So far the new curriculum already made 35 million students got a benefit. Of course, not everybody like the postmodern idea. The teacher, especially lots of teachers, they like the traditional way. I talk, you listen. That's easier to manage a classroom, right? If every student at the centers, you can see, you know, in 150 students in one classroom, you can see how it's hard to manage, right? So that is why a lot of teachers, they're not so happy, you know, with the new curriculum. But anyway, I think something good, something already started. Nobody really can stop. So gradually we think we will go that way. I think that is in this way, I think more and more children, you know, will get the benefit. That means not only focus on memorizing. You know, 1 + 1 equal 2, something like that. Also can focus on creativity, curiosity, something like that. I think that is it's very, very important. See, the fifth one is help China to turn to ecological civilization. So it's, you know, right now China, in the past 30 years, we mainly focus on development, growth, the GDP growth. Yes, that's why in China right now, GDP become second largest body in the whole of the world. But the cost is too huge, especially the environmental cost. See, like so you see our mountain, see our sky, right now the smoggy in Beijing. So that is really, really the become very, very, very bad. Seriously. So that's the constructive postmodernism make people realize the cost of the environmental cost. And so that's help China make the turn to ecological, technological. So because the CP can provide a philosophical foundation for the ecological civilization. Because the traditional Marxism, they still emphasize the human being conquer the nature. And also called the based on human centralism. But the process of thought emphasizes the harmony between nature and the human kind. So that's the difference. This is the Pan Yue is one of the leading figures in China in the environmental movement. He's the vice minister of US, the EPA, right? EPA, yeah. Environmental Protection Department. Yeah. He said, ecological civilization is a critical absorption of environmentalism, eco-ethics, and postmodernism. You can see the right now the government proposed ecological civilization is not come from nowhere. The influence there. Everybody, a lot of people work on this direction. Yeah. So it's make it happen. This we have a female author. Yeah. It's the he used to be the vice when she was 39 years old, he was the vice mayor. Yeah. He said she said CP is the philosophical foundation of ecological literature. Yeah. So she writes a lot of very beautiful ecological literature. This is another our eco hero. Her name is Cheryl Liao. Yeah. Maybe some of you already know her. Yeah. In the past 18 years, 70 years, she worked on the environmental movement. Yeah. But help the community in the city to set up the system of recyclable system. But she found the more they work, they have more problem. So she realized that it's not enough just change people the way, how to do the recyclable. It's probably the time to change people's mentality, change people's way of thinking. That's why eventually she found the constructive postmodernism is very valuable. Yeah, can help people change their mentality. Yeah. So the 2007 she got the John Cobb Common Good Award. Award. Yeah. So it's the also the last year the Xinhua News Agency come to Claremont, interview us, asked us to give some suggestion about the China's ecological civilization. We said probably maybe it's time to set up a build some called special zone or special area, 特区, for the ecological, called a special ecological zone. Then this year, the central government announced they are going to build the Fujian province become the special ecological zone. We don't say, okay, we are the only person but suggest them, maybe some other people also do this. But anyway, you can see, yeah. The influence there, yeah. Another question is very important. People wonder why CP can mushroom in China. You know, after the China opened the door, every day, every year, there are a lot of movements, new movements, like phenomenology, and ethical philosophy, yeah. As the hermeneutics, a lot of movement went to China. But why, I don't say only, but why constructive postmodernism is so become so influential? Yeah. So it's, I think there is when you watch deeply, observe deeply, you will find there can find 10 reasons. Here, I just list 4 of them. The first one is the need of the society. You know, after the China, the open the door, right now, China need new idea. New idea. Because you can see, okay, the lot of right now in China, you can a lot of people still mentioned the liberty, democracy, science. And so of the first enlightenment that we promote, this kind of idea. So that's a lot of people think, okay, China should need a democracy. Yeah, this is the bigger movement in China. The point, the government say, okay, China, China should have their own characteristic, 中国特色. So don't the westernized democracy doesn't fit China. So you can see the two champions conflict each other. Yeah. So this is the, is there a third way? Can transcendent? This is a dichotomy. It's an either or dichotomy. I think the process of the constructive postmodernism provides the third way, called both end. Both end. I think the this is a lot of new idea, yeah, from different field, called postmodern law, postmodern economy, postmodern, you know, the sociology, psychology. So the many field can provide fresh air, yeah, to society. Another one is very important is the have deeper affinities or convergence with the Chinese tradition. This I want to mention more. Yeah. So therefore, Professor Yu come from Jiangsu Normal University. Where is the Yu? Yeah, stand up. She come here want to study on the convergence between Taoism and the CP. Yeah. So it's the there is a lot of convergence between CP and the Chinese traditional culture, yeah. So this is the according to Professor Tang, you know, there is the way the constructive postmodernism emphasizes on the harmony between nature and between nature and the humanities also have a deeper convergence with Chinese tradition, yeah. Also as Taoism, because the Taoism also emphasizes the holistic view, yeah. Treats the whole universe as a system, organic system. So everything interrelates each other. That's why in the beginning I mentioned ask the give me a hand because the finger related to your heart. Yeah, so everything is related to each other. Yeah. So this is the Taoism. Yeah. And we also got the postmodern monk. Yeah. Because of the it's very funny. Another one. Yeah. Not this one. Many years ago, probably more than 10 years ago, I went to Chicago join the conference. During the conference, a scholar come to me. The scholar is the Professor Wei, this one, yeah. Work so the in the Chinese Academy of Social Science. He said, Professor Wang, I want to treat you. I wonder why you want to treat me. I didn't know you. He said, I bought a lot of your books, you know. I got a lot of lecture fee through the, you know. I asked where did you teach lecture? He said I lecture in the temples. So I was well welcomed by the monks. I said, what did you talk to the monks? He said, I said, okay. From the point of view of modern, the monks, you're out, you know, out of date. But from constructive postmodern point of view, you are advanced. So we call it a postmodern monk. That makes those monks feel very happy. Yeah. Yeah. Because you know, when you go to the Chinese temple, you find the temple are very clean. All the Chinese temple are planted around by the trees. Also, Buddhism emphasizes become the vegetarian, right? No killing. Also, this idea have deeper convergence with the constructive postmodernism, and also with the environmental movement. Yeah. That's why. So in this way, you can yes, they become the advanced movement. Yeah. So that's why the got welcomed. Yeah. Yeah. So this is in the Professor Mary mentioned our book Second Enlightenment. Here, I want to see one more word about the why. This is we use the word, the phrase Second Enlightenment. You know, as you know, the first Enlightenment in China, especially in China, 100% copy the Western Enlightenment happened in Europe. Yeah, in Europe, which emphasized the democracy, science, and liberty. In China, we call it Mr. De 先生, Sai 先生. Mr. Democracy, or miss the science and miss liberty 和这个什么自由小姐啊，李小姐啊，德先生、赛先生、李小姐，嗯，所以的 ，but after the hundred years, you can see the negative consequence of democracy and science and the liberty, yeah. So the because back to the first element, a lot of Chinese leading scholar, leading person want to China, go to westernize, go to modern. Think by modernization, that means westernization. Yeah. But consider China's population, our human resource, our natural resource. We don't think it's a good idea China copy the American development model. Yeah. Can you imagine that, you know, every Chinese have one car? You know, this is almost become disaster. How many Earths do we need? Yeah, and the so that's it. We think the another big character feature of First Enlightenment is a totally abandoned tradition. This is a tradition, just a trash. Yeah, I think that's inherited from the Europe tradition. They think the tradition is totally is trash. We should embrace the new, yeah, the modern. So it's but you know, when you're totally abandoning your tradition, where you can stand? You have no land, right? So that's why a lot of people right now become rootless people. We call it empty people, empty people. This guy, okay. Yeah, I just give an example. Everybody heard of Fan Pao Pao? Yeah. Back to 2008, in China there is an earthquake. Have you heard of earthquake? Yeah. A middle school, high school teacher in the class. When the earthquake happened, he teaching in the class. Then when he found the earthquake, he's the first people run out of the classroom and go to the safe place. Later, the student ask him, teacher, why you abandon us and run away yourself? Did you know how he answered? He said, I am a liberal. I believe that my life should put in the priority. He said, even my mom here, I will not take care of her. I will take care of myself first. That's liberal. That's the people understand what is the liberal in the China for the most the young generation. Yeah. I think that's also probably influenced by the First Enlightenment. Yeah. So it's the later I will tell this other story, but that's the his story. He said, I think he just make a story. He said, in the West, the university classroom, you see, they already write down here. The teacher should protect themselves first, put their life first. They said they put this kind of guidance on the classroom. I think you know that's also a lie, not true, right? Yeah. The here, teacher also take responsibility, have a responsibility for their student. Yeah. I think that's the you can see a lot of misunderstanding, misinformation there. Yeah. And the another point is that the affinities with the Chinese. This is wrong. I think it's through the Marxism. Yeah. So it's, I want to because Marxism is also care about the poor people. The poor people, the minority. So that's why we have a lot of for the common good. Yeah. You know, that's why you can see why back to 1920, 30, why Chinese people eventually pick communism, socialism. Because that's they think that is the have deep convergence with their own tradition. In China, we call it 大同. People favor this idea, yeah. Communism. So it's the yeah. There are a lot of deep convergence there. Yeah. Yeah. The another point is the constructive postmodernism can help China find the third way. I just mentioned it before. Yeah. The third way, that means in many ways the third way. I just give you a short example. There is a judge finished a judgment. There is a wife sued the husband who have an affair. Then the judge said, okay, just follow the rule and 3 years put the husband in jail. The judge take no money from the wife. Everything just objectively follow the rule. Everybody think, okay, the judge is good. People think that it's a very good, right judgment. But after the judgment, after the judge announced the judgment, the wife give her baby to the judge. Here you go. And walk away. That means the wife didn't feel satisfied with this result. Why? Because he still loves the husband. Because if you put my husband in the jail, who take care of our family? But right now in China, we have a lot of young lawyers, young judge. They learn the Western textbook. They just follow it. Yeah. Because we should consider Chinese situation, the economic situation, people's feeling. That's why we propose the new idea called the law with feeling. Yeah, it's kind of a combination. Yeah. You say, is it possible to have a third way? In China, a lot of people laugh at us. They think we are idealistic. History must follow step by step. China has to develop first, become modern first, then become postmodern. No other way could go. This is the only way, follow the schedule designed by Marx. Yeah, history follows this way. But this is the example we call a postmodern Yaodong cave. Traditionally, this is the traditional cave. It's good, have deep connection with nature. But it's bad, look ugly, right? Not fancy. Also, humid. It's also not a good light, not have good light. But this way, look very modern. But inside, very tradition. So it's a good combination, perfect combination, tradition and modern. So I would call it a constructive postmodern. Yeah. Make sense? Yeah. You see, in China, no need still follow the modern, we can jump. Like this way, right now China, the solar system, right now China already take lead in this way, yeah. So this is one of the largest solar city, yeah. This is another example. This in China we call a harmony train, very fast, yeah. So this is from Beijing to Xuzhou, it will take 14 hours. Right now, that's 2.5 hours. So there's two professors, they come from Xuzhou, yeah. So right now, China's train system technology is very, very far ahead than the US. Yeah, so we no need just the copy, step by step, we can jump. But when you go to China, you're welcome to take a train, but you have to buy the ticket, yeah. It's very, very fast. One hour, per hour is more than 200 miles or something like that. Yeah, of course, we still, even they become very influential, become very successful, we still met a lot of challenges. Yeah. The challenge one is from the orthodox Marxism. They think, okay, we should follow Marx's design, the plan, step by step. Yeah, so we still think we are idealistic. Also, some people still influenced by the scientism. They think, scientism still in China very influential, and they worship science. Yeah, and also the mechanistic materialism. Yeah, those things they think okay. For them, it's hard to accept CP. Yeah, but we still think there's hope there. Why I still become so optimistic? Because I trust I like Lu Xun. What Lu Xun said, hope is like a path in the countryside. Originally, there was no path. As people are walking all the time in the same spot, a way appears. 时间本没路, 走人多了就是多了。 So the reason why I feel optimistic because I can see a lot of individuals take action. So this is from the government side. Chinese central government already put the ecological civilization into the government's party's constitution. Do you know how many party members do we have? Anybody know? 80 million. 80 million, yeah. This is that's the bigger group, right? Yeah. So this government already decided to go to ecological civilization. I think that is a good sign, yeah. So, and from the also the right now half of the Chinese province already decided to reduce GDP, yeah. Even the government right now they decided to promote official not in terms of their GDP, in terms of their how happy people feel in their city. So this is the big change. From the people's civil level, a lot of people that take action. People probably know the Ningbo event. Yeah, so there is a chemical plant. Yeah, so they want to set up in the Ningbo, and people went to street. You know, after people went to street, so eventually the government shut down. Yeah, this is the event. Yeah, this is it works. Yeah, when people voice their opinion there. So this is probably people know that we got a witness scholar, Professor He. Yeah. He went to countryside to help rebuild the countryside community. Yeah. So when Xi Jinping, our new leader, went to their village to listen to her, you know, how do they? Right now, the China's countryside, most countryside become empty. Yeah. How to rebuild the countryside community, that's a very, very important work. Yeah. So this is our hero. We want to mention his name, An Jinlei. He has 40 Chinese mu, plant organic food. So every year, he even leave the 5 Chinese mu to plant the 小米儿, 怎么说? Like the smaller rice. Yeah, do you know why? He planted a small rice. He wanted to feed the bird. Why he feed the bird? So after the bird have the free lunch, the bird think I should do something for this guy. So the bird eat the worm, the insect. So in his farm, no need for the pesticides, you know, 杀虫剂,
pesticides,
no need, because the bird already take care of them. It's a very negative circle. Yeah. People ask him, right now you become famous, you know, you probably your neighbor will be jealous of you. How do you deal with your neighbor? He said, I even can harmonize with the worm, the bird. It's not a big deal, harmonize with my neighbor. Yeah, so it's this is really something, yeah. This guy probably somebody know. Sui Yongyuan, yeah. He's the CCTV host. In China, everybody know him. And he has been against the GMO. But you know, the agriculture department, the mainstream keep quiet. All support the GMO, yeah. But he eventually think I should do something. He used his own money, come to US, come to Claremont, LA, to interview American people. From the clerk in the supermarket, to professor, to scientist, yeah. Eventually, he made a video and a show in China. So really right now, you know, right now I think last month, Chinese already turned down a lot of Americans' GMO soybeans. It works. Yeah. This is the Zheng Bin is the lady. Yeah, I should mention the her name. Yeah. So 30 years ago, he was an elementary school teacher. In the beginning, he sold chemical fertilizer. Then she realized in another good way. She started to sell ecological fertilizer. But the people don't understand. Yeah. Then she helped organize the community. Right now, she got a club already have 3,800 members in her club. Yeah. It's really the important thing I want to mention to her. For most of the two kind of rural community, still no young generation. But her community already attract the young generation, I mean the college graduate come to countryside. Before, most people think, okay, this is only one way after graduate that go to city. That's why I go to college. I want to get a job in city. But her college already attract young people come. Yeah, so I think that people feel here, so have a fresh air, fresh water, you know, clean water, and people have a community much better than in the city. Yeah, I think that is a big change. Yeah, and also this called wedding. So a lot of Chinese people, young people, they found them on the way to go to green. Yeah, so this is the wedding, the bride and the groom, the couple, they have the postmodern wedding. The totally 200 volunteers join them, take a bicycle with them. Yeah, I think pretty soon I think they will have a CP baby. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Time for some questions?
Yeah. Feel free to ask.
I'll get things started.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool, right? I'm interested in these ideas very much, and I'm just learning about them now, and I think a lot of people here are just learning about them for the first time. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the differences between postmodern thinking as it's broadly construed, as most people think of postmodern, what you call deconstructive postmodernism, and that is the French school. And I learned a little bit about this as a graduate student. Very, very challenging theoretical material, sometimes growing out of Marxist thought, but sometimes based on this idea that we need to challenge the modern experience, modern growth. And guys like Foucault, Derrida, and the rest. And I know you're steeped in this, and you've studied a lot yourself. I was wondering if you could talk just a little bit about that group, and then, because I think some people here are also unfamiliar with some of those thinkers, a little bit about that postmodern thinking, and then how this presents an alternative, a little bit of what the difference of postmodern constructivism is.
Okay, that's our good question. And I used to write a book about this kind of postmodernism. So this is the leading part is the Jean Derrida and Foucault, both of the French philosopher. Yeah, I think the also including Lyotard. The main point is that they want to call the deconstruct the metaphysics. Yeah, this is they think I think they're to this way. They're from my point of view, maybe there you can write a book about the different. But the two here I want to point out the two. One is they focus on the text, language. According to Martin Heidegger, he said that language is the home of existence. So that's why they are so emphasized the language. That's why they do not really care about the society, what's outside the language. Yeah. Language is everything, and that's why it's very rarely found that they care about something ecological. I think at the beginning they focus on the called the literature. So that's, for example, a novel. Most of the people want to find the unifying element, okay, and find the coherent logic. Yeah, but their way reading the novel want to find the contradiction. Yeah, want to find the self-contradiction inside your book, your point, something like that. So when the traditionally want to find the unity, they want to find a contradiction. Yeah, so that's the also they focus on the difference. Yeah, that's the another point is the we emphasize the constructive. They emphasize the deconstruction because they think every theory, when you want to build something, you belong to of the ideology. Yeah, you have to totalize. Yeah, so that's why they are very very cautious build something new. Yeah. So that's the big difference. That's why, you know, especially in the feminist movement, some people don't like them. They think you deconstruct or underline deconstruct the subject. Even women, you deconstruct. But who is the agent of struggle? People need to hold together. Yeah. So that's the one of the two main points. We differed from them. But of course, this movement more influential than us because, especially like the young generation, they like rebellion. It's easy to turn down old house. It's hard to build something. It needs more work. Yeah, that's it. Please.
You're talking about how constructive postmodernism is about mixing the modernizing aspect and the traditional aspect. What happens when they clash?
A good idea, good point. I think for the both side, I think both of them have a problem how to transform themselves. Not okay. So that's why we think there's a lot of good value in Chinese tradition. But we don't mean that every tradition is good. Tradition, we don't want to romanticize the tradition. Like, you know, in traditional Chinese way, they bound women's feet. The bounding feet, you don't think this is a good tradition, right? Yeah, so we need to, yeah. So some bad, we should still need to abandon. But the modern is the same problem. Not everything modern is good. There is, right now, though, you can imagine a lot of the Chinese young generation, they spend the whole month's salary to buy a called the handbag. You know, so they think this is modern life. Yeah, you know, that is we call it 月光族. That means every month I spend out my money called 月光族, empty my salary. You know, that's the kind of modern we also need to avoid. Yeah, so this is but there's a lot of good side in the modern life, yeah. So it's like encourage individual participation, take responsibility, you know, hard work, a lot of good idea. This can be the combination, yeah.
You're talking about some of the barriers between the acceptance in China of this new constructivist CP benefit. One of them being Marxism. So what would be some of the conflicts between this theory and Marxism, traditional Marxism specifically,
or everything? Yeah, this is the one I just mentioned. The traditionally Marxism, they think we call it the production force. The economic is a base. So every society developed must be based on economy. Right now, China, we haven't developed yet. Our economy foundation just so low. How can we China will go to postmodern? You jump too much. You have to, you know, when China become modern, like rich, like US, then we clean the air, you know, which develop later. We go to postmodern. First, we should become modern. Then we become more strong, you know, yeah, something like that. Yeah, that's because that's why Marxism traditionally focuses on the economic. Economy is very important. Yeah, so that, but my point is that I like to question them. If we follow your logic, how could possible the Chinese revolution? You know, even the October Revolution, Soviet. According to Marxism theory, first you should become an industrial society. Then you have enough proletarian, wu-tan-jie-ji. You have enough working class. Then you do the revolution. But China, 80% we are farmers, but we still did the revolution. So that's why I think the Marx see the in the German design. The history, I think China should not just follow what Marx designed. We should base it on our own reality to change. Otherwise, you know, a society cannot survive. Yeah.
So, in kind of going off of what you said, in China is the constructive postmodernism, is that
trying to implement a different form of Marxism, or a different approach to Marxism, or no?
What's the question?
I think what you're saying is constructive postmodernism serve as an extension of Marxism, or a new direction for Marxism?
Yeah, new direction.
Okay. Yeah,
you're right. That's a very good question. When we talk in China, some Chinese Marxism, they identify ourselves as a kind of a Marxism. They call it like a organic Marxism. Mm. They think we are part of the, yeah. Of course, still they are different there. But people may put us in the same camp. Yeah. Because, you know, right now, because we immediately focus on care about the poor people, the countryside, the working class, I think that shares deeper concern with Marxism. Yeah. About the maybe another question, probably you want to ask about the science. The CP, because the Whitehead himself is a scientist. He's a teacher of Russell. Yeah, the mathematician, right? Mathematician. So this is the so that's why constructive postmodern based on the modern science. So that make have a more strong, you know, foundation there. Because the modern people worship science. So that's why probably Whitehead is the five of the person alive in that time who can argue challenge Einstein. They call it theoretical ethics, theoretical physics. So that gave constructive postmodernism kind of a more power there.
The issue of consumerism is interesting.
Yeah.
Professor Minqing Pei from Claremont,
yeah.
McKenna was here, and also Professor Carl Gertz from UCSD talking about politics in China today and the economy. And one thing that they both see, they don't necessarily advocate, but they see as a definite direction that many forces, both in the Chinese government and the American government, are pushing is more consuming in China. And a lot of people in both governments encourage consumption. But that seems to be directly contradicting the conservationism and the ecological civilization of postmodern constructivism. So you talked about the provinces scaling back their projected GDP figures. Is that part of a project to accept a lower GDP growth rate throughout China? And if that's the case, it seems you must have a lot of opponents in the Chinese government who say, no, it needs to be growth, number one.
Yeah, it's a very good question. You know, you're right, you know, because the consumerism become very, very powerful, you know, the become very powerful in China, you know, that it's hard, really, you know, to pursue the a girl, give up her handbag, you know, yeah, it's very fancy, that look like a fashionable, yeah. But I think the situation is changing, yeah. From the government level, the province level, when the government reduces GDP, that means the probably they will focus on the quality of life, not also the quantity of life, yeah. How, you know, the reason why the young people, they are crazy for shopping, just my explanation, because inside the empty, they have the crisis of faith crisis. Probably I call them empty people, or the people with empty heart, they have to use the stuff to fill in, make them feel good. So right now the young people, because the First Enlightenment, you can ask a Chinese young generation, ask them what is the Confucianism, they will say no. What is the Taoism, they will say no. What is the Buddhism, they will say no. You can try. 90% will say no. Because the First Enlightenment, we think the tradition is trash. But when you lost your own tradition, your own faith, your own spirituality, what do you have? So I have 12 GRE, GRE 12, you know, a mass. That's not kind of help you hold something. You know, feel happy, feel good, right? Yeah. So recently in China, there is the very, very rich guy, Zhang Chaoyang, right? Yeah. Do you know Sohu? Sohu, yeah. Sohu.com. Yeah. Very, very rich. Already right now, he's around 40, 45. He's still single. In China, we call people like him a diamond single. Diamond, I mean, you know, rich, you know, yeah, and handsome. He said, the reason I'm not can have girlfriend and wife, because I doubt every girl, every female who approach me, I think they come for money. You know? If you think this way, how can I make a friend, right? That's why right now he got a depression. Yeah, I'm seriously. The tree also got depression. The tree mentioned that the tree introduced his doctor to him. They are so rich, so handsome, but right now empty. Yeah. You can see the consumerism, I think, couldn't solve the problem. So when sooner or later, we realize that it's not the right direction. Yeah, we probably found something deeper. Found something more meaningful. Yeah, I think that is why, one of another reason people easy to accept the CP.
Yeah.
Green GDP.
The quality of life of
the the government, the policy change is very, very important. Tell a little bit the Chinese policy. Because of the, not here, China, every leader, local government official, is the central government appointed, right? Before, they said, okay, if the GDP high, you got a promotion. But right now, the government changed the policy to see whether the people feel happy in your city. That becomes standard. So that is the I think it's a big change. For the official, they have to, you know, adjust the policy. Yeah. Also, Chinese people, they like also, of course, we don't have the Western style democracy, but we have our own democracy. People have many ways they can make their voice be heard by the top leader. So that's why, you know, in the past 1 year, already we have 23 high official committed suicide. Yeah, because right now they call the against the corruption, the new movement. Right now, new leader took over the power, launched the big movement against the corruption. A lot of even the minister were put in jail. Yeah, so it's like there are so many channels can get the information.
Yeah.
You talked about a third way,
yeah.
And that was the law with that feeling, right? It was that's the way to respond to
yeah.
the young lawyers that want to follow the law books word for word. I just want to know, is there a reason for the resurgence of like a bunch of young lawyers? Is that because more people are like graduating from law school?
Yeah.
Oh, is that why?
And the one is the law, right now in China we have 100,000 lawyers. Yeah, it's a big grow very fast. I think most of them graduated from law school. Yeah, some of them got their degree from West. So that's why their training, the modern training. Yeah, they think law is law. Yeah, something like that. Law is not only law, right? They're everything interrelated each other. Law related to society, economy, feeling. Yeah, that's the where society is complicated, reality is complicated. That's why I think the third way should found. There's not a given third way. Always you should found third way, based on the reality. Yeah, because you know the in China is so huge, big. Each area different. You can't ask the Harbin people plant the rice. Because no enough water, right? Yeah. During the Mao's time, sometimes Mao like the people. Every countryside should plant the rice. It's a mountain. How can you plant the rice in the mountain? So that's why in the local people, not really listen to the central government. There's also some tension there. Yeah, but in some sense, it's good. Yeah, that's make your society survive because you know, like Feng Baiji, you know society very well. So the local people know very well, so the policy is the most suited to them. How can you listen to somebody from a couple thousand miles give you order? Because he didn't know the society. The law is the same situation. In China, because in traditional Chinese society, we don't have people feel ashamed to go to law, go to judge. Most of the time, people solve the problem. If you and I, we have a fight, the Murray, set up a table, we can have a dinner together. Then after dinner, okay, you tell what's your problem, what's your problem, what's my problem? Then he gave it a judge. Probably said, okay, maybe it's your problem. You should apologize to me. Okay, it's okay. So it's because yes, solve the problem. People think that's the way. Yeah. In this way, we still keep the harmony. But the modern way, yes, you win, but I hate you. Mm-hmm. You know? That's why the more lawyer become more unharmony society. I don't say lawyer is a bad guy. Yeah. I mean don't solve every problem. Yeah, lots of people I think we can in the community can solve the problem. No need to go spend a lot of money. I have a classmate working for the superior court. So one day, one of my friends asked me go to back door to talk to him to help. One of the kids, he said, "Tell you the truth, tell your friend, withdraw the kids. You know, otherwise." After 10 years, 5 years, you spend a lot of money, eventually the same problem. You just better, withdraw, much better. Most of the case, we can solve ourselves. You go to the court, spend a lot of money. The lawyer in China, we follow the, first the got the money from the defend, and got the money from the, what's the defend?
Prosecutor.
Yeah, see? It got the both sides, yeah. So this is the lose-lose situation. That's why traditionally Chinese people don't like go to law. So when you become a postmodern lawyer or judge, you have to think this way. You found some way. First, you should know what they really think. What's the best solution they want to get? Then you found a compromise way. Everybody feels satisfied. That's it. Yeah. Better give the money to Jeremy.
Yeah. In this way, is there a push in the CP and the constructive postmodern movement towards stronger local governments, more autonomy within the province or the town or the village?
Yeah, I think, yeah, we also encourage the individual, the citizen, have empower, you know, that's it. Because they know the society very well. They know which way is the best way. Yeah, so that's it. I give you a small example. I went to the Yongji here. I hope someday you can go there. Yeah, this is Yongji. This is the, they got some American, 这个什么 baby bamboo, can eat, baby bamboo. Yeah, the investors think they can make big money, because in China they become a kind of fashionable food from the U.S. can make big money, so spend probably like $100 million money to build a big farm builder. But they got a problem. They got a kind of worm eat the root of the baby bamboo. So they use American pesticides, yeah, want to kill the worm. Doesn't work. No matter how many you put on the plant, still there, alive. Then eventually, what we can do, they found a bottom full of the pesticides and put the worm inside it. You know what? Still alive. So American insect very strong. Then eventually the local farmers solved the problem. He found some 辣椒水, 花椒, named pepper. 花椒, mam, nam. Very small, yeah, like you know. This very 花椒, very eaten, very named. 麻, 花椒,
pepper, it's a kind of pepper.
Yeah, yeah. Then use this water, kill the insect. Sorry for the insect, yeah. But that means the so you can see the local people really had the wisdom. Because their ancestor, many, many years they live there, they know, you know, very well, yeah.
Okay, so going off of that, we have been a lot of local solutions that seem to be the best solutions for world problems.
Yeah.
Also, with the focus on ecology, though,
yeah,
there are the ones that there are the projects that require a lot more expense in the beginning to get them started. So, like we have the solar farms and things like that that are very expensive to get started. Where would some of that funding
originally
be coming from?
Yeah, right now the government, the 2009, I went to the Hunan province, that's Professor Yang's hometown, Xinxiang. We see the government want to encourage, you could call it the mass gas.
Methane?
You can use the waste, animal's waste can become the gas. Methane gas, yeah. So it's probably it cost like 100,000 yuan Chinese money. The government provide like 50%, yeah, and the villager you can put another half, yeah. So they put another way the government help the almost right now in China, each villager they pave the road there, yeah. So it's they do some way, but the problem is right now. The problem is that the young generation, they think the city can make big money. The city life is a civil life, modern life. That's why if you stay in the countryside, they think you are a loser, something like that. I think that is also influenced by the First Enlightenment. Yeah, so that's it. That's right now China government want to reduce the gap between the city and the countryside. I think that is a good sign. Yeah. That is very, very important. I know the reason we just have a conference in Oregon, Professor Wen mentioned the reason why China can stand so many economic crises, because we have a so large amount of community, countryside community. So when the city good, we see one city not good, we go back to our home. Countryside. So that's why even Cultural Revolution, Mao is so strict on the socialist system still criticize that every family have a close a smaller property. You can plant your own vegetable, you know, food. Yeah. So that's either the still have some, you can see the, that's the like a pool, you know, can help adjust, balance the society. If you have some problem city, you have a place to go. But right now the US, you know, we here people only have, all America only have 2% farmer population. So that's totally become the more urbanized, yeah. So that's why we think not a good way for China totally go to American way. If go to American way, 98% of Chinese become the citizen city. What they will do? What they will do? You can imagine they are in city. Right now, the female villager in countries in city, they do massage. Yeah, you massage, and all do the nanny. For the man, they do the construction worker. But 10 years later, every city almost finished the modernization. Almost no building need to build. What they do? I don't think they need so many people do the massage, do the, you know, yeah. So that's the big. Also, when they are poor, no job, they are also living in the countryside, also live in the city, like in India. There are bigger pimin ku, like lots of poor people in the city. That become a big problem. That's not a harmony society. Also, it's not good for the safety of society. Yeah, when some people were very poor live in the city, you can feel the anger. Yeah, so that's easy to cause any rebellion. Yeah. I think the best way to build the China countryside, make it beautiful, sustainable. People feel there, feel got root, feel have the sense of belonging. I think that's very, very important. Yeah. Some money is important, but the money cannot buy everything. Yeah.
One more question.
Okay.
There are two moments in the 20th century, especially when we see a lot of Chinese traditions that you're talking about reviving being destroyed. One is Wuse, the May 4th movement, yeah, the first enlightenment. Uh-huh. And of course, the other is the Cultural Revolution. And these are times when, in the 19-teens and 20s and the 60s, when people are very excited, and they're in the streets, and they're protesting, and they're destroying, like Foucault and others. Where is the excitement going to come from to construct and to build and to get young people, students especially, involved in reviving traditions like Taoism?
Confucianism. Yeah. I think that's a very good question. Probably I can answer him.
Sorry. 就是对这个年轻人，他们怎么来让激情啊，鼓励他们来重新欣赏中国文化啊，恢复中国文化？你们有没有any good suggestion? I think from my point of view, probably that's why we want to have the summer academy. Young generation, you know, for the conference, the lecture, I think this is the way we can do. So this is the, I think another way from the pressure from society, because when you totally abandon transition, you will feel empty. Your life will be live a miserable life. That's why in China right now, the young generation, a lot of people got divorced quickly. We call it lightning marriage, lightning divorce. I know you one day, that's next day we married, then the next day we divorce. Because they don't know how to interact each other, compromise each other, just be me-centered. That's a totally modern culture, you know, me-centered. That's the kind of, if two center, one family only one center, how can we allow you two centers? You can see the conflict there. I think the reality will push them learn some lesson for that. Then also our education also very important. Like the in the Whitehead kindergarten, we emphasize the people, the children, how to do the cooperation. Yeah, that's the teamwork. That kind of value traditionally. You know, the traditional Chinese, we don't like go to extreme. You know, do you know biandan? The Chinese, they call it biandan, is something can carry. You know, there is a while you carry two basket, yeah, there could be biandan. The one point is make you is very economic is the middle point. That's why people carry here is very light. Yeah, sorry. That's either the middle way. The Chinese, that's why we in China, that's why we call Chinese Zhongguo. Now the China is the center of the world because Chinese culture emphasizes the middle, the mean, middle way. So Chinese don't want to go to extreme. So if you see somebody likes to go to radical, he's not Chinese. You know, I think the education is very important from my point of view. The when we were small, we studied Chinese, we just by memory. Like my name, Wang, you know, do you know my name, last name Wang? My teacher just asked me to remember. 1, 2, 3, 4. Totally 4 stroke. Yeah, 四画. But why I studied after, that's why I really appreciate the CP, the second element. We started helping me, I realized, wow, the first line, every line have a meaning. The first line represents the heaven. Yeah. The third line represented the earth. Yeah. The middle line represented the human being. The person link heaven, earth, human being is the king. So I'm the king. Yeah. So Wang has a meaning. So sometimes when I was small, if I study my last name this way, no need to work very hard to remember the meaning there. Yeah, like Chinese, like the rest, xiu. That's one part is the human being, one part is the tree. One human being against the tree, you got the rest. That's a shoe. So we no need to study so hard. So that's why I think we can make the transition is more attractive. Yeah. So in this way, probably gradually I think we got a resurgence. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, yeah. Professor Wang.